Namaskaram, my name is Ramya Harishankar and this is Dance Conversations, a digital documentation of conversations with peers, colleagues, collaborators and mentors. A retrospective of Indian dance in Southern California. I'm delighted to have here with me my friends Anu and Mala to chat about our guru, the legendary Kalanidhi Narayanan. Malavika Sharukai is a world-renowned Bharatanatyam exponent based in Chennai, India, and Anuradha Jagannathan, a senior dancer and teacher, now lives in Toronto. Welcome, Mala and Anu, and I truly appreciate you giving me the time and spending this few minutes having this precious conversation. Precious because it gives us an opportunity to briefly relive those wonderful times and certainly carefree as we realize now. So welcome again. Even though the three of us, you know, learned from both our gurus, Swami Malaike Rajaratnam or Vadyar as we called him, and Kalanidhi Narayanan or Mami as she was universally known, our paths never crossed because we all had one-on-one lessons with both our gurus, and it was really outside at events or gatherings or performances that we did together that we met. So Mala, you moved from Bombay to Chennai and having learnt originally from Kalyan Sundaram Pillai and had your Arangetram there. So when did you start your lessons with Mami?
Well, first, you know, Ramya, I must actually thank you for, you know, initiating this kind of conversations because they're long overdue. And somehow I think the pandemic and the isolation has actually made it more important to connect, to reconnect and to make these bridges, you know, between people, between our experiences. So I really have to thank you, and meeting Anu on this discussion is also absolutely fantastic. So I'm delighted. I'm delighted.
Thank you.
Really delighted.
I agree.
Yeah, I was pretty young when I came to Chennai and Madras, as it was called. So I think I should refer to it as Madras. This shift was made because my mother believed I really needed to dance, and Madras was the place I should come to. So I think I met Mami in, I started training with her in 1975, early 1975. So that's really long, long ago. And it came about because of many things, I think, because, you know, YG Dorisamy was such an important influence. My mother knew him. And of course, my mother was absolutely passionate about dance, and all she wanted me to do was dance. So, you know, coming to Chennai and, you know, it was a natural choice to train with Vadyar and, of course, Kalanidhi Mami. So, I don't know, things came together. And like you said, you know, there were... Those were days of kind of leisure, you know, when dance was absorbed, I think for all of us, perhaps, in a very sort of slow and easy manner. You know, it wasn't about learning fast pieces and things and quickly consuming something to dance on stage. So, yes, it's a long journey, but wonderful. And I think Mami coming into my life was just a breath of fresh air. I mean, it changed just so many things, the way I looked at dance. So yes, yeah, 75, early.
Yeah. How about you, Anu?
I came to Mami in 1977, and it so happened that actually Vadyar took me to Auntie.
Wow.
And she was living in that house in, I forget the place, but she was living upstairs.
Road.
And
Mobley's Road, right?
After that.
Okay.
Annamalaipuram.
Right.
And Vadyar took me to her because I had a program at Sai Gana Sabha, and he wanted me to learn a padam and a javali. He said, "And amma kitta poi kattuko." So I didn't know who Mami was, and he took me to her personally and said, "There is a program, and you know, you have to teach this girl. She's a student of mine." That's how I came to know Mami, and didn't look back after that, because it was kind of a different kind of a journey once I came under Mami's influence. So it's 77 was the first time.
So I also started learning from Mami in 1975. Mm-hmm. I graduated from college in April of 75 and started with Mami in June, I think, of 75. And it was prior to that, I think a few years before that, NMN, who was a renowned critic, dance critic, had written about one of my performances in Madras, and of course said, you know, everything was very beautiful, whatever, but there is no Abhinayam. And I remember crying for several days. I was very young and traumatized by that. But of course, Mami wouldn't teach unless you got an okay from your primary guru, you know. So we had to get an okay from Vadyar to, you know, learn from Mami. And so, as both of you said, I think it changed my life going to Mami. And I have to also mention how, as Anu just said, I can't even believe that. I didn't know that. But he was really generous and open-minded and liberal to allow so many of his students to learn from Mami. And actually, some of us were fortunate to be able to continue that for a neck, you know, forever. And I know Mom Vadyar would say, "Eppadiyo andha ma andha amma eppadiyo andha maramunjila pesa vachudra." He would say that, you know, she could make wooden faces emote, you know. So so I think he truly admired her and, you know, gave us the freedom to learn from her. So I do you know, cherish that and appreciate that. So I think another important element is that we were there when Mami was just reinventing herself as in her new avatar as a teacher of Abhinayam. And so she was forming her own philosophy, her repertoire and structures, and we were actively participating in that, you know. And I think, I don't know how much I looked at it, like, you know, in that way. At that time, I don't know if I was mature enough to appreciate that. But I think when I look back, I think those were special times, you know. Don't you think?
Absolutely.
No, I think what was really, you know, quite magical was the fact that, you know, we didn't realize it, but actually all three of us were learning with Mami at an incredibly wonderful stage of her, you know, as I said, reclaiming the dance, and, you know, after this 30-year lapse of a complete retreat and coming back. And I remember in classes, you know, there was a sort of simple wonderment about, you know, about hastas. If you keep a hasta here, it means something. If you move it a little bit. And she was actually sharing that momentary discovery with us. You know, it wasn't something for her which was done in the past and she was retelling it to us, but it was actually happening for her. So it was, I think classes had a kind of electric energy, you know, about it, because she was on this glorious path of recovering herself as a dancer. I mean, it was just like no words to describe training with under a guru who's experiencing that, you know. It was incredible, yeah.
And it's very organic, and you know, and as you mentioned, Mala, we learned at a very kind of, I always tell my students, you know, though we went to class three times a week, it would take months to learn one piece, you know. It's not like we learned a piece a month or you know, literally we would learn two or three interpretations of a phrase, you know. And you know, kind of marinate in it and think about it and ponder over it. And then it was a very slow and organic process. And I don't know if that even exists anymore, you know. What do you think, Anu? What are your impressions of what happened?
No, it was never a question of saying, okay, auntie, I want this, so shall we do it and finish it? It was never that. It was always a very, very slow process. But she made us also understand many, many nuances, which till then I was not very familiar with. Even though, having danced for a long time, it was a totally new opening with mommy's way of method of teaching her, the way she would explain things to us. And nothing got done without that explanation, which was something that was totally different from previous learnings. Of course,
I think Vadya may have been able to do it, but I think in those days it was really a challenge for a male guru to be explaining or dissecting a javali or the content of a padam and explaining it to a young teenager. You know, it would not have worked, in particularly in those days. And so I think that is the element that mommy brought. Being a woman, she was able to break it down and give it to us in a manner that we could absorb it, you know,
and understand it better. Because learning from Vadya, learning Enneramum or Varugalamu or something was always easy. But other things like Padari Varugade and all that, I remember this Padari Varugade because I asked him something and he said, Mani Pannuma, you know, that was there. He couldn't explain it. Beyond that, it was difficult for him to say anything.
I know.
But with Mami, that limitation was not there. So she would tell us exactly what it was and that was a big change.
Yeah, I think in a way, as Mala said, probably because she was thinking also about what she was creating or what her style was going to be or what her philosophy was going to be, she made us also think, right? In the sense, she didn't give it to us in a platter, you know, it was... She would give us so many things and we would have to sort through it and, you know, put it through a sieve and come up with the concentrate of how we wanted to structure it for ourselves and what worked for us and what didn't.
You know, something which really startled me when I came from Bombay, because after all, I was a Bombay girl and going to a co-ed school and stuff like that. But when I came and started learning padams with and javalis from Mami, what was really astonishing was her very bold acceptance of all those emotions. You know, sometimes I think she seemed even more contemporary than I was. I mean, I felt a bit, a bit lost in these emotions. But Mami had a way of, you know, just taking it by, you know, taking charge of these very complex Sringara emotions and statements, you know, and ideas. And she used to startle me by her progressiveness, her progressive ideas in a way, which I think, you know, I was reading Lakshmi Lal's book on Mami, you know, wonderfully brought out. And it speaks of her... actually, perhaps she was very conventional as a person, but I believe in the dance that she created, in the pieces, that compositions that she was able to, you know, take up to it for interpretation, she was hugely bold.
Yeah.
I mean, she and was bold, you know.
And I wonder if it was because of that she was very conservative otherwise, you know, to kind of justify being bold on the other side, because she said, basically, I'm not like that, but on stage, I am that, you know.
I think she gave herself that freedom as a performer, as an artist, you know. Yeah. But in life, she was very domesticated and very conventional and, you know,
and conservative.
Yeah, and very conservative as well. But somewhere in the dance persona for Mami, she was like a firebrand. I mean, she was just fantastic. I mean, she did a lot of very like unusual pieces, you know, compositions that she took up.
Remember that at one of Ranga Rao's birthdays at Anu's house, this Rao requested Mami to do this piece, which was performed by a call girl or a prostitute in a film, a Kadave Shatadi or something, asking the friend to shut the door. That guy is a useless loser, don't let him in. And he asked her to do it, and she was game. She got up and did it, you know.
Not only did she do it there, Ramya, she also did it at NCPA in Bombay.
Oh, she did?
And she did this in NCPA, and there was a lot of people talking as to how could you do this, you know, how could you do something like this. But she was bold enough to do things like that, which is very strange. For a person who was that, who came from her background, quite conservative, orthodox, but when it was jazz, it was a totally different Mami that you saw.
I remember one of the first things she said to me when I started learning dance was, in the vekkam adallam vandu moota katti machila potuttu va, you know, like there's no room for inhibitions and shyness here, throw it up in the, in bundle it up and throw it in the attic, you know, so, and then come. So I know she, I mean, that was, I think it also gave us the freedom to, and I would say on those lines that actually learning, and I was going to ask all of you as well, that learning from her really gave me a voice and a freedom to say or speak things that I would never otherwise do. You know, in my real life, I would never have the guts to say things that I could say through a padam or through a javali, you know. So I think that is what really connected me to dance, and the ability to own my own dancing and not just be following directions, you know. So what do you think personally that you got, Mala, from Mami, and how have you in personalized it in your career, you know, to suit your philosophy?
I mean, so many things, you know, which one learns. And I think what was special about her classes were that, I know I spent hours with her because, you know, I had, after the first year of going to college, and then when I was so really bereft of everything and all I wanted to do was dance. And then, you know, my mother and me took this absolutely reckless but absolutely wonderful decision that I should only dance. And so I had the whole day to just like hang around her, you see. So I could see many more classes, and I think I learned a lot from observation, not necessarily talking about it, but just looking at her and, you know, internalizing in the through myself. So I think that was like a percolation over 10 years. Of many things, one learned of, you know, sort of almost learned resonances, not just the tangible of a padam or a javali. But if I look back and I say what was startling for me with her classes was her positioning of hastas, and, you know, where she put it, the space that she used. And I also believe at that time, how I learned from her was there was a lot of stylization, a lot of natyadharmi, which, in a sense of keeping the arm, elbows up and stuff like this and moving the body, that made a huge impact. And I still remember her for that when I'm doing some things, you know, and using gesture and saying, what is the space that we're using? Why is it that a gesture changes you know, the idea changes, so much changes in the sheer placement of a gesture, leave alone the movement of a gesture, leave alone the mukhaja abhinaya of a gesture, leave alone the angika of a gesture. I mean, there's just so much to it. So her classes were about nuance. You know, her classes were about this angika, which she used, I think, brilliantly. You know, in some of the photographs I was looking at in Lakshmi Lal's book, I mean, she's in this sari and, you know, with that whatever she used to kind of pallu, which used to come wrap around in the front, you know. But I mean, she looked glorious and in that. But if one looks closely at that, you see a very sharpened sense of angika, which even perhaps she didn't talk so much about. But if you look at the photograph, you see it. And I think those things were very precious learning for me, very precious. And then I think I later on I moved and I worked on it to find a technique which works on my body, you know. And you say, how does this language of dance or language of gesture, how do you own it? How do you make it your own so that it sits well on you, you know?
Yeah.
So when you dance, it looks honest because obviously we can't dance like someone else.
Absolutely.
So I think, yeah, I mean, one can go on about it, but there's so much. I mean, it was covering new ground. My classes with her were always new terrain, places I had never been to. She took me there.
Yeah.
You know, so it's like, I mean, it's just great luck that all of us were there at that point to learn from
Absolutely.
Her, I think, you
Absolutely.
Know?
Absolutely.
Yeah, it was precious. Yeah.
How about you, Anu?
Like Mala said, many days I would sit after class because she never objected you sitting there and observing a class of another person as long as that person doesn't feel shy or whatever. So many days I've sat there and watched the same padam that was taught to me would look so different with another person. And the number of nuances that she would take it through, brilliant ideas, which always, you know, I felt, where does she get it from? And I've even questioned her a couple of times. Mami, enge endu mami, neenga ipdi la yojana pandreenga? Ella varudhu di, that's all. That's how she put it. It just comes. So I don't think she ever did anything thinking it has to be this way or that way. It was her natural way of expressing herself. So we were very lucky to have been there in those formative years. And
it's true. I think maybe we were older. I mean, I joined in 75, so I was older. I was more focused on dance. As Mala said, you know, that was the goal to learn and absorb, and perhaps the way she taught as well, you know. I also spent a lot of time, invariably after my class, I would hang out for an hour or so observing how she was. I really was curious to read her mind, like, why does she think that way, or why is she interpreting it that way? And to me, when I look back, and what I've actually come to realize even more and more and more as I teach more and more, is the is some things we did subconsciously is to create these subtexts, right? And the conversations that she gave, she would do the either and verbalize it, right? Verbalize that line, and that's something I for sure did that. And also was trying to read her mind even when she did Abhinayam in class. And that's why, as you said, I loved watching her in class even more than in a performance, because I think in those moments there were brilliance, you know, there were brilliant moments. And in fact, I often tell my students I would watch her like a hawk, because it'll be like a flash and it'll go, and you say, Mami, can you do it again? And she'd be like, என்னடி பண்ண சோ யூ நோ இட்ஸ் gone இட்ஸ் gone அண்ட் தென் யூ ஆர் லைக் ஓ மை காட் தட் வாஸ் such a good idea I wish I had held on to it you know and so I would watch her so carefully whether it was my class or another class that I was just sitting in on just to catch those little moments you know and I feel like as it's interesting how each of us look at certain aspects of what mommy was doing and teaching and for me that inner dialogue to really come from and as Mala said it has to come from within and you have to own it you cannot copy me to some extent you can but at some point you have to own what you do and be honest and authentic right and so I feel like this inner monologue or the subtext is so important and that is really the mirror to me right say I you know when my students say oh should I look in the mirror for, I said no you the mirror is inside you that's how you check whether what you're saying or doing is correct logical meaningful and is being communicated to the audience so
you know I yeah. just remember you know Ramya talking about you know learning with mommy I remember initially as when you're saying you know when you learn with her initially you do have to copy her because you're trying to you know get that grammar or get that punctuation that she's getting so there is a great sense of acute observation which has to then become a bit of a copy and yeah. I remember in the early years you know must have been the first 2-3 years I was learning with her and she'll say panna panna you know like do expression and I used to tell her but I am doing expression which obviously never came through you know she said feel it you know you have to feel it no feeling venu and I used to say what is my guru saying I'm doing my best but obviously nothing was like being reflected you know through my face and then you understand that actually doing abhinaya is excruciatingly difficult
it is
you know
it is.
And then getting your face first of all to become a little mobile without looking awkward you know sometimes yeah. you see dancers and it's looking awkward on their face and yeah. you're saying just to make it just look decent and express and then if you think of you know bringing all the hastas in and body language and all the other levels to abhinaya the layering of abhinaya it's a huge language of communication
Absolutely.
But I remember sometimes getting very frustrated with mommy because she'll say you know innu panna panna and I was like you know I was like going full out you know all engines firing and nothing was actually coming on my face so you know we've gone through that teething trouble you know to start yeah. saying how do you express I mean it's difficult you know I think Nritta is that way much easier isn't it
you know
usually
students think oh it's hard to do Nritta because you have to sit in aramandi and you have to sweat but actually I tell them the way we teach or the way I do abhinayam it's way harder you actually sometimes I remember I used to get a headache from just thinking you know just sitting and thinking and trying to understand and absorb a padam I would get a headache at the end of it you know so it is much more difficult and also the way mommy style was right with the layers and the weaving of the different emotions in a beautiful tapestry it was not like plain anger just do anger you know it was not black and white like that you know there were so many other layers to it so yeah so we were talking about how we met and I do you recall the Thursday sessions right that we used to have with mommy and VAK Rangarao we would have discussions and debates and Anu do you remember
I thought it was a Friday but I could be wrong too
do you remember
Friday Mara? Or Thursday but it was a 3-hour session
didn't matter. I know it didn't matter which day it was but those were really
I remember yeah
yeah those were special as well because it was outside of class and I remember I would debate mommy and discuss about how why a particular padam should be interpreted this way and not that way and of course Rao would add to the drama
and to his very Rao would add to the drama and to his obstinate refusal of anything else, because he had one way of looking at it, and that was it. And I think he expected everyone to sort of follow in those footsteps, which I must say I did not want to do. Yeah. I always kind of disagreed with him on several points.
As did Mommy. They would have arguments and about Mommy would be like, why should it be that way? Can't I do it this way, you know?
But it was all, those were the times when we learned more. Reading chapters from that Understanding Bharatanatyam or even there was another book, I don't remember the name of the book now, but they used to read chapters from that and then try to talk about it. And that kind of gave us a lot of insights into whatever we were doing. Till then, it was all kind of on the surface, but it taught us so many things. Those discussions were really, I think it was very fruitful for us to understand it better, understand the whole language better.
I think as Mala said in the beginning, I think Mommy was also kind of expanding her horizon, and we were part of that journey with her, you know.
Yes.
So which was very special and truly a treat to be with her in those times. Anu, the other part of it, of course, one of the things was we went on this weekend trip to just us, right? Mala.
To the temples. Yes.
To the temples in Kumbakonam and Brihadishwara temple. And that was really, really special to go with Mommy, you know. It's too bad we don't have any. Do you have any pictures? I don't have any pictures or anything of those. It's too bad we didn't understand the importance of it, and we, of course, we didn't have, I don't have a camera.
Ramya, I have some pictures.
Oh, fabulous.
Of that particular trip. So I'll share it with you through email
that'll
or something.
Be great.
So,
yeah, that'll be great if you can. So, I will add it to this video. I'll edit it in. Yes. It'll be nice. So Anu, I wanted you to, yeah, go ahead.
You know, that particular trip, I think we started off with Chidambaram, went to Dharasuram, Patteswaram, and Brihadeshwaram, of course. Mommy had this Upliyappan too, yes. Mm. And everywhere, Mommy showed us all the sculptures there. And I even remember we were all posing like the sculptures in front of those sculptures. And I have those photographs. In Dharasuram. But it was one of the most memorable trips. We were never able to do that afterwards, but I wish.
I know. Absolutely. Yeah. Particularly now when you look back, those good old times, you know, carefree.
Yes.
Anu, I wanted you to share about how this chamber concerts. Happened at your parents' lovely home in the atrium, remember? It's kind of ironic that when Mommy started teaching, these padams and javalis had to be reintroduced to Chennai audiences, Madras audiences, and it was kind of like semi-lecture demonstration concerts, right? Thematic that we did.
I think it was the formation of Abhinaya Sudha first, and Mommy wanting to, I suppose, going out to a sabha and dancing, maybe nobody would have, allowed us or heard us. So when Mommy, I think, asked my parents, would they, because the big hall was such a huge place that at least about 50 people could sit there and watch, they didn't have any problems. And we've had some lovely sessions. I think we started off with Ashtanayika. So the first one was Ashtanayika. And I remember Kanditanayika being done in that house. Because she said, like you said a little while earlier, you said Kanditanayika, it's not just anger. There are so many shades of sarcasm, anger, you know, hurt, pride, everything. So I remember we've had a session of different Kanditanayikas with, I remember Muttavadra, I remember so many other things, but I think we performed almost 6 or 7 times in that place, if I remember right. And every one of them was a, and only later on we started going out to the sabhas or wherever we went.
I think we did Alvar Pashuram, you know, the 9th century poet, and then we did Annamaya, compositions of Annamaya and Kshetriya, both 16th century. So, Mala, were you a part of that at some point? You were, no?
Yeah, definitely. Because in the, for, you know, I trained with Mami for 10 years. Yeah. So that's 75 to 86. I mean, in most of those, most of those programs which we used to do, even in that, what is that other small hall near near TTK
Shastri,
Road?
Shastri Hall? No.
Shastri also. You know, we've done, and I feel even there, you know, Kalanidhi Mami was a trailblazer in a way, because when she thought of putting, let's say she had a concept which was contrasts and parallels.
Remember? Yeah.
Correct?
Yeah.
Yes.
So when she does something like that, I think she was re-looking and repositioning these Sringara Padams in a way and giving it a certain narrative, you know, a certain story to it, which was not done in those days. I mean, you know, I think she was the few who were actually, she was quite again forthcoming that way, to say she'd look at Padams in these different, you know, groupings, which was very interesting. I thought it was very interesting, you know, instead of just doing a whole range of Padams. But it also makes, I think, the audience think, the dancer think. There were other things happening with it.
In fact, these little chamber concerts grew, you know, the audiences grew. So I remember, in fact, the last performance that I was a part of before I left for the US was at the Museum Theatre. And I think we did Kshetriya Padams at Museum Theatre, if I'm not mistaken, in 1981.
Oh.
And we Yeah. No, I just, Tamil Shri Sangam was the place where we did the Alvar Uhanda Kannan.
Yes. Yes.
And after that, we went to a number of temples. You know, those days, I don't know, I remember Srirangam. That was what was coming to my mind. Because in Srirangam, I mean, it's so sanctified, and all those people who came to watch us were so, I mean, it was, I don't think anybody else would have done something like what Mami did, with Velakudi telling us the description and the meaning. And we've gone to many temples and danced through that particular Alvar.
So actually, I moved to the US in 81, and then within 6 weeks of coming here, I came back to India and didn't come back to the US for 6 months after, till 1982. So that is when we went on this Ashtavidha Nayika tour to Delhi and Bombay. That was fun in many ways. Remember Rao dropping at the air conditioned market in Delhi in the middle of the crowd and embarrassing us again.
Not unusual. But you know, when you talk of programs, you know, Ramya, I remember when we were talking of 81, I think it was in 81 when, you know, she was invited to teach at the Sorbonne in Paris. Mm-hmm. And I had gone to do Odissi. That was my first like trip abroad, and I was dancing Odissi with my Odissi guru. And Mami was taking a workshop, and she was taking a workshop in this kind of a cathedral almost, you know. So it was terribly cold because there was these high ceilings, but she was on the stage and she was taking class. And what again what I remember of Mami is the ease with which she was able to adapt, coming from Madras, coming from her background, etc., to be able to live in a hotel like this and drink tap water, you know, because we were so startled. Is it possible really to drink water from the tap? You know, which we didn't believe at all. For some days we bought bottled water. And we said, no, we can actually drink tap water, which we did. But her teaching was, you know, she was so much in command, which I also, I think there was some other thing to her personality, that she could go to these different places and actually not feel out of place. Though it was very different for her, but
yeah,
I remember those sessions, you know.
So Mala, I think I already we talked about, you know, how we've personalized it and in our own performances. But I think and we also talked about how much homework we had to do for each of our pieces. So as a mentor today, is that what you expect, or what is the style of teaching that you have adopted?
Well, you know, there were many, I mean, this is a very long story, so I'm going to make it very short. Because, you know, there was a time when I taught a lot of students, and I did Arangetrams in Chennai. I think three students, who went through Arangetrams. I actually did, you know, from Teyatey onwards to Tillana and Varnams and et cetera, et cetera. And I went through the whole sort of Margam. But when I looked closely at the whole Arangetram, the scene, you know, it didn't really interest me. Also because I felt that the dancers who I taught actually went and did a lot of other things. And why not? You know, they didn't become dancers. They just went on to do other things. And that's when I just decided that I would not teach in that sense, you know, have a school. But I would rather mentor a few who are already into dancing. Yeah, who are already like serious dancers. And I say, if I'm spending time with them, I would like to just focus on them because they are dancing. So that was more, shall we say, rewarding for me to teach them. But, you know, I think there have been lots of like departures I have made over the years. You know, since we are being so candid about, you know, in our conversation, I've had lots of discussions with Mami, and we agreed to disagree, basically. Because, you know, she was of the opinion that all Padams and Javalis came in the Jivatma Paramatma, you know, of understanding of, and that's how she looked at it. And I often asked her questions, mind you, after many years of training, you know, as to how is this, why is it, explain it, contextualize it for me and all that. And I think at one point she said, you will not understand all these things. So that was a finish point. So since I questioned so much of the Margam itself and the position of women in the Margam, which became important for me as a contemporary woman, that actually I moved away from the Margam a lot, as you all, both of you know, because I've just done a lot of other work. And exploring, you know, other emotions or other terrain, other ideas, I actually found that I had to work on the language of expression in a different way. So I could not keep it padartha, you know, I could not keep it so word for word, but I had to move it more into the essence of a line. So it started taking me in a different direction, which, you know, I've worked at for the last 40 years to work at it like this. So I think the training that I do for dancers, like when to answer your question, is really to say, you know, the language, the physical language is important, but beyond it is intention. And it is the intention that you hold, that if you shift that intention a little bit, the hasta also starts looking something else. Body suddenly starts, for example, I mean, just imagine it. if somebody turns their back, okay, to the audience, okay, and we hold the hand like this, okay, and we're looking backwards like this, like a, just a pose, say.
Yeah.
If one is thinking in the mind that it should be attractive or look at my body, by holding that in the mind, the whole physicality changes.
Absolutely.
Whereas if you hold the same thing and you're just saying it's pure dance and it's abstraction, then it looks different. So it looks different and you're doing the same thing. You're really not shifting anything, but the mind has shifted. And therefore, it's like almost coloring the whole body into looking different. So when you start looking at it, I think for me right now, mentoring is about energy. Mm. It's about saying, what is the intention? You know, hastas and all that are the easy part. I mean, that's the external. That's simple. It's easy to figure that out. After 10, 20 years of dancing, we can figure it out. It's not difficult.
Yeah.
But to get the mind to be in the body, to inhabit the body, you know, and work on intention, I think that's what I would like to train dancers on. So that the articulation of the body becomes more refined, more nuanced, you know. So it's a different kind of teaching, shall I say, that I'm doing now. You know,
that's
besides, it's a different way of looking at dance. And but I enjoy it because I think both me and the student and the dance, I can't call them students because they're all wonderful dancers in themselves. You know, we all travel another path. And we're just open to discovery. And when I teach or mentor, then I'm also learning. And I'm excited about it.
Yeah,
I'm excited.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Actually, in the pandemic, I mean, I also don't teach beginning classes. I haven't taught for over 10 years now. Till they're about 10, they've trained for about 8 years at least. But in fact, during the pandemic, I have started teaching Abhinayam to older, more serious adult dancers, and it's really invigorating for me because they also contribute to the process, you know, when they do something or they express something, then it makes and also forces you to think, you know, and I really enjoyed. So that's been one of the pluses for me during the pandemic is to connect, and some of them are my own students who don't live in the area. And now I do it online, but it's really exciting for me. And actually, it forces me to think beyond, you know, like you said, the basics, like hold your body up or hold your elbows up. I'm not even concerned with that. I'm just concerned with how can they own what they do and personalize it, you know. How about you, Anu? What are the challenges as a teacher, do you think?
Challenges are, I often find that when I taught in Madras, it was different than teaching here in Canada because the exposure that these children get here is very, very minimal. They don't see that many programs and it's generally, it's only on YouTube or something like that. So they're thinking is kind of different, and always it's a generation, I think, you know, when you teach a padam and then their question is, why should we listen to what a man says? So this is something about Netrandi Nerathile,
which Mala asked too.
But you know, just to tell you, the first padam which Mami taught me, just imagine, she taught me yetane shonnalum. So perhaps that puts it in perspective.
You know? Actually, Netrandi Nerathile was the first person that I learned with Mami. And I don't think I questioned her as to the ending or why it was being done that way. But every time I have taught it here, I have always been questioned. So, you know, thinking is different. Times are different. So you have to move along with the times. You have to, you can't say no, just do it. I can't say that anymore. So I try to make it as understandable, and I try to change it a little bit so that they don't feel, they love doing things things like, you know, where the man is pushed off, they like that better than being subservient. So times have changed. That's all it is.
Absolutely. And with generation to generation, and also the location, right? And
yes.
So one has to really be selective in the pieces that you choose to teach or perform, you know, and also adapt it. In some ways, Padams and Javalis allow that. I mean, that's what I feel. For instance, Mariyadaga Teliyakane, you know, which is a Javali, I always interpret it, not always, now I do interpret it as, I remember, you know, Mami saying, okay, you know, like your eyes say yes and your lips say no, or, you know, when you say Mariyadaga Teliyakane, oh, he is, you're enjoying the attention that he's giving you, but you're complaining to your friend that he is, you know, harassing you. So now if you complete, of course, it, you completely take out the fact that he's giving you attention and you just say, hey, there is a way to behave towards a woman and this is not the way you talk, or so you look at it from a different perspective, right? You see it. So then, you know, the kids are like, oh, I can, you know, I can relate to that, you know, or even ni matale. Right. So when I said at the end, I was teaching a young girl and I said, OK, at the end, I'm going to say, you know, it's really not about the jewelry that you did not bring me, but it's about you keeping your word and, you know, and the fact that you broke your promise. So that's really what concerns me. So they were like, oh, I could relate to that, you know. So I think in some ways you have to modernize and appeal to the sensibilities of the new generation and yet try to teach them, you know, a few of the padams and javalis because they are beautiful, right? So I think we have to grow and yet keep some of the things that we learned from Mami.
But don't you think, Ramya and Anu, you know, because both all of us have been trained classical dancers and we've seen in our own lifespan, like we've seen a lot of changes happening, like Anu, you're talking about, you know, how it is in Toronto, you've been in America. But I really believe that if we want tradition in a sense to continue, we have to question it.
Absolutely.
You know, we have to question it so that we take, you know, intelligent and informed steps on what we do with tradition, because otherwise we find ourselves rather obsolete.
Absolutely. In fact, I hesitate to use the word tradition because it keeps changing, right? It's an evolving thing. It's not something stuck in a particular time or era or space, right? It's something that's evolving and it's very gradual. So you sometimes don't notice. Because I remember even Mami telling us that, oh, you know, we used to dance for 3 hours and all. We used to, people will come and just say, can you either konja abhinayam pidi? So, you know, so it has changed and it has evolved and it has to, obviously.
But you know what I find, you know, looking at the dance scene overall, that women are still enjoying this very man-centric world. They like to portray themselves in a man-centric world and play the part, that stereotype, you know, that they're supposed to play. I just find that it leaves me in question, saying, you know, I'm talking about Gen Next. I'm not even talking about our generation. I'm saying Gen Next. When they have learned their margam, etc., but overall the kind of tone that they give their pieces, you know, it's also the tone. It's like, Ramya, you were saying how you can shift it. If you want, within it, you can shift. It might not be cut this and do something, but within it, you're making small shifts, which are actually big shifts, But I'm quite, I'm confused and I have no answers for it as to why women are still playing these roles of such, playing this thing in a very man-centric world. When they're giving them, so then I said, you know, I don't know why it's happening. Perhaps it's just comfortable. Perhaps it's just, you know, it's easy. Because if you want to do something else, it's actually very difficult. Whereas if you know you work, it's actually very difficult, and there's a lot of risk when you go out. There's risk. I mean, all of us have seen that, you know. But as I said, some of these questions remain, which I have not solved. So if any of you have any ideas, please tell me. Seriously, I really want to know, you know. I just want to understand what is happening to dance, because, you know, we have lived at a time when classical, the solo, all that was like, you know, it was prized. Mm-hmm. It was prized for what it was. But now it's shifting. Many things are happening. And just mm-hmm. to understand, what does Gen Next want? Where is dance going? I don't know. As I said, any...
I don't know.
Yeah, anything on that, I would love to know, because I'm always wondering and, you know, just wanting to know what's happening to dance, you know. But anyway.
You know, I agree. I think for us in the diaspora, it's not just about thinking about dance and how to shape it, how to adapt it to the diaspora. It's a challenge, actually, in an interesting way, because when I came here, I was one of the early ones. I came here 40 years ago in 1981, and there was no dance, active dance scene here at that time. I find that it's not just about teaching the students, it's actually about teaching the parents, the community, and creating an audience and creating an appreciation. And having many of them having grown up in India in pre-Mami's time, or perhaps not been exposed to her art, always would question, like, why are you doing padams? What are they? You know, what is this place in Bharatanatyam? Because I've never seen any of this being performed. I've never heard of it. So it's kind of shifting the way people see dance. Even the people who came, the first generation Indo-Americans, right, who have very limited exposure. Because my students come from all parts of India. And as Anu said, they have no exposure or very limited exposure, and come to class once a week. So there are several elements to it, you know. One of the many hats that I wear, one of them has been audience building and creating a space to present dance, Indian dance in particular. And that's how, I think, Mala, you were here in 2005, right? I was just checking my calendar, and I think we presented you in 2005. Anu, it's 15 years. It's crazy. And Anu was here with Mami in 1989 on the Krishna tour, right? And then with Vadyar, when we all toured the US in 1994. In fact, actually, 1989, when Mami came and we were going to present you all, was when we officially inaugurated Arpana Foundation, our presenting wing of my school. And then it kind of transformed and morphed into a physical space called the Ekta Center. So we actually presented Mala under the banner of Ekta Center. And we have a physical space, you know, which we allow for people to teach Indian arts and crafts and culture to a larger audience, you know, to a larger community, I should say. So I wanted to also acknowledge, you know, Jagu, Anu's husband, and Harish, my husband, who are like sons to Mami, and, you know, really supported and helped her so much in those days, particularly with forming Abhinay Sudha and, you know, all the related paperwork and all of that, you know. So as we conclude, I wanted to acknowledge, you know, that for 45, I just, as I was thinking about all that, I was like, oh my God, 45 years, we met in 75, and it's now going to be 45 years, and it's been a long journey, and as Mala just said, we've all had our own paths and that we've chosen to go down and pursue. But I think Mami was the genesis and kind of the root from which we all
Absolutely.
Sprung forth.
Very true.
So so thank you so much in the midst of everything that's going on for joining me in this conversation. And it's I'm sure it'll serve the future next gens and it'll be documented digitally for posterity.
I just wanted to say one thing, Ramya, that I really marvel and appreciate both of you for doing the kind of work you're doing in the diaspora. Seriously. I don't think I would last even 2 weeks there to be able to, you know, put in seriously the effort, you know, of teaching people and, you know, the dancers don't have that kind of background. And like you said, once a week when they come for class, whenever I come to the US or, you know, I'm traveling abroad and I see the diaspora, my admiration only goes up. To say it's just amazing, the effort, and I think your passion for the dance, you know, to continue and to teach, you know, I really want to just acknowledge it to both of you, serious.
So thank you, I appreciate
really,
it.
Really, truly. Truly.
But Mala and truly. Anu, I have to say, I have to conclude with one statement that Mami made to me when I left for the US. And I know she was not happy that Harish and I were leaving, particularly not just because of me, but also because Harish was like helping. I mean, Harish and Jagu were helping so much. And she was like, why do you have to go, you know? She said, Niyu poi anga dance class aramikada, you know. And she said to me as I left, and meaning that don't you go and start a dance class. And I didn't understand the significance of that statement, or I didn't take it seriously. It was like, oh, just another thing that mommy says, you know. But I had no intention of starting a class or teaching when I came here. But there was no option. Otherwise, I would have to go work in the corporate world, or, you know, how am I going to be associated with dance 24/7, and that's the only way it was to teach. And I had students waiting, knowing that I was coming here. So there was a kind of a school waiting for me, so to speak. But I think what I interpret that statement from Mami is to be honest and have integrity in whatever you do. And I think that's what, you know, I've tried to do as I near nearly 40 years. This.
True.
Anu?
I don't know. I don't think Mami told me anything when I left, but she wasn't happy when I left in 97. Mm. Going to Nigeria, she said, idu kanda madri oorukellam pore, because it was quite a thing. But she said, wherever you're happy, both of you are happy, just go. And of course, we kept in touch. I did go back and learn from her even after that, but she's been a huge inspiration for me. So in every way, she made me teach. She gave us
you
classes.
You taught the
to
male
learn.
Students, Anu.
Yes, because she said Narayanan Mama will not allow me to do it. So I'll tell Jagu, ni unna kavala padade. So.
Which I think,
No, go ahead.
I was just thinking of Mami in her later years, you know, much, much later years, you know, when we have all moved on and done things and she was still teaching. And I would visit her, you know, as often as I could. And what I found more and more with her was behind this very rather stern sort of, you know, exterior that she had, a little bit of formality, you could always not really quite step over. That later on, when I used to go and hug her because I felt so much affection for her and I didn't know how else to say it to her, she would let me. Yeah. She would let me, you know. And there was a kind of softness and a mellowness to Mami which I saw. which was, again, you know, those were those moments that you remember her by, that inside this person, there was this very warm-hearted, affectionate person. You know, she didn't show us so much affection, but I think she felt a lot for us. I think she felt for all of us, a lot.
Absolutely.
Actually, I have to say this, just this last thing. I lost my mother, was quite young. And so the first time I went to class after that, he said, you know something? I'm here for you. I'm your mother now.
Yeah.
That was mom. She had a very tough exterior. She'd hold back her emotions and all that.
I have to share something funny. When Anu and the group had come in 1989, and they had been performing this Krishna piece all over the US and all over Europe, I think, and they were here. But she would insist that every morning they get up and practice that. And they were like, oh my God, we've already performed it like 20 times. You know, we should still be practicing. And she would get up in the morning and finish cooking. You know, she would, before we even got up, and we were like six young women here, six or eight. And she would have, by the time we got up and came down, she would have already cooked lunch. And she'd be like, okay, Ella ready. Ella vango practice girl. And we would be like, oh my God, not again. And we were all grown women, you know. But she was, I mean, that's one of the ways of her strange ways of, expressing her affection. But when she traveled abroad, like in the U.S., she only would stay with her students and like her students from India and select people. If anybody else invited, she'd say, I'll come and have a meal with you, but I can't stay. I'll only stay with my students. I will not stay with any new dancer, new person, you know. So she was very particular, very principled in certain ways. So we can go on and on about all our experiences. But thank you again. And look forward to continuing these conversations in other spaces.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.